It's 2015, and God wants us dead. He tried to wipe us out already. A cataclysmic blast that tore the planet apart almost did the trick. The second impact, as it came to be known, was very nearly our own extinction event. But there's enough of us left to warrant sending in a cleanup crew. A crew made up of deformed, hellish beings known as angels, to mop up what little is left of the human race. But deep below Tokyo 3, a new power is stirring. Our only hope of salvation. A team of broken kids piloting biomechanical beings capable of going toe-to-toe with these genocidal beasts. They are known as God's in his heaven, and nothing will ever be right again. You've never seen anything like Neon Genesis Evangelion. It was hailed as revolutionary during its original release, and 25 years later, it still feels just as subversive, as insidious, and as important as it ever did. It may have adhered to, or even originated, some of the most popular anime tropes of its time, but something seriously sinister lies behind its brutal fights and seemingly innocuous fan service. On the surface, Eva is a mecha show like any other. Pilots Shinji, Rei, and Asuka must hop into massive, bestial robots to defend Tokyo 3. As the futuristic city sinks below their feet to protect itself, these children must fend off the relentless attacks of the angels. Rei is quiet and contemplative. Asuka is hot-headed and eager to prove herself. And Shinji is a troubled teen who struggles with abandonment issues. Whilst their conflicting archetypes occasionally, and predictably, butt heads, however, their interactions are just the tip of the show's narrative iceberg. Deep below the city, in a vast underground base, watches the rest of the main cast. Making up a shady organization known as Nerve, they refuse to operate in black and white terms. Instead, they act exclusively in shades of grey, and their machinations for the future overlap uncomfortably with their mysterious pasts. They are as interesting and integral to the show's forward momentum as any of the oversized fisticuffs happening above. Deeper still, an unseen force plays puppeteer. The strong, unmistakable voice of a creator echoes throughout the run, and it's this voice that makes Eva the horror show that it is. It's terrifying to watch, not because of some great swell of tension punctuated by a loud jump, as the genre so often relies on, but something deeper than that. Something that resonates with all of your own insecurities and self-doubts, and rarely ever offers comfort or reassurance. Instead, it doubles down on those feelings, delivering a psychological drama so harrowing, you feel scared not just for the characters in the show, but for the people who are making it. As Evangelion builds towards a climax so unique and personal and confounding, the question on every viewer's lips stops being, "What's going on here?" and inevitably becomes a question of a different nature. Are you okay? Director Hideaki Anno was not in a good place when he started work on Neon Genesis Evangelion in 1993. He had been part of the animation industry for over 10 years at this point. Anno had risen to moderate acclaim with his college friends by making impressive animations for conventions and even a bizarre, beautiful live-action Ultraman fan film, in which he played the titular hero. This group would later go on to form the studio Gainax, but not before Anno studied under Miyazaki himself on the pre-Ghibli film Nausicaa of the Valley of the Wind, and lent his own apocalyptic stylings to that film's stunning close. But by the early 90s, the stressful life Anno found himself leading as a director in a newly founded animation studio began weighing on him. During his work on 1991's Nadia, The Secret of Blue Water, his mental state began, by his own admission, unraveling. This was exacerbated by his follow-up projects getting cancelled mid-production, leaving Anno in a lost and aimless state of existence. It was at this juncture that his friend Toshimichi Otsuki told Anno to bring him something, anything, and he'd make sure it would get greenlit. Anno brought him Neon Genesis Evangelion.
あえて楽観的な気分を排除した舞台から物語をスタートさせました。そこにいる14歳の少年は他人との接触を怖がっています。自分はいらない人間なんだと一方的に思い込み、かといって自殺もできない臆病な少年です。そこにいる29歳の女性は他人との接触を可の中限り軽くしています。二人とも、いわゆる物語の主人公としては積極さに欠け、不適当だと思われます。だが、あえて彼らを主人公としました。新世紀エヴァンゲリオンには4年間壊れたまま何もできなかった自分の全てが込められています。自分の気分というものをフィルムに定着させてみたいと感じ、考えた作品です。結果はわかりません。
In Japan, Evangelion has always been massively popular, despite how divisive it was upon launch, and how much controversy it has courted in the decades since. It's been a staple of Japanese culture since its debut. With its striking mechs as identifiable as the likes of the cuddly Totoro, and a cast of immediately recognizable characters, it grew into an instant classic, and a merchandising machine. But despite being just as popular amongst anime fans worldwide, for a long time, it was impossible to acquire through official channels. 2019 marks a rebirth of sorts for the series. In a momentous move, Netflix acquired the rights to stream the show earlier this year, bringing Ava back to the West, making now the perfect time for the uninitiated to finally check it out. Despite its legacy, Evangelion isn't the intimidating epic that it's often made out to be. It's a classic that has aged gracefully. Its action is slick, its long-held shots and atypical direction are daring, and the show at large is as entertaining, as shocking, and as vital as ever. From laugh-out-loud humour, to that palpable, character-driven horror, Eva is a multifaceted beast. One that uses its 26-episode run to leisurely unravel its best-kept secrets. It sometimes buckles under the weight of its own jargon, but the pseudo-science and stuffy politics of its wider plot are always tethered by the fantastically flawed players at the heart of it all, a heaving cast that each take turns in playing hero, damsel, and villain alike. Wrangling this mess of egos is no small feat, yet Anno and company do so admirably, carefully taking each two-dimensional stereotype and shaping them into a full-bodied, terrifically realized and hauntingly compromised person. For a show that was famously being written and directed episode to episode, with finished cuts being provided mere days before release, this accomplishment is staggering. For the longest time, Evangelion seemed to be a triumph of pacing until, quite abruptly, it wasn't. Evangelion was not the show anime fans expected. It did not offer the type of narrative its viewers were used to, and it has carved itself a legacy that absolutely no one could have seen coming. Indeed, Evangelion has been defying expectations since its debut, so it should have surprised no one when its climax was anything but ordinary. Despite this reputation, the ending to Evangelion was a hugely controversial affair. As the show crept towards its close, as not just the stakes of its narrative, but also the production itself are raised considerably, Evangelion abruptly changes gear. as it turns its attention on the pain psychology and existential dread of its characters, the pessimism that was always lurking in the shadows takes center stage and threatens to swallow Ava whole. This final act begins to feel like a feedback loop for Anno's waning mental health. In every broken character trying to save a broken world, there's an ugliness that reflects their creator, an ugliness that is focused on and judged mercilessly. And this strong sense of self-loathing feels like a cry for help. Ava had been operating on a metaphysical plane long before its final episodes, often turning inward to explore some of the show's more heady beats. But when the show closed with an hour-long deep dive into the human condition, instead of some grand final battle, fans were outraged.
Don't leave me. Don't ignore me.
Don't kill me!
What the hell is this?
Some theorized that time and budget constraints explained the deconstructed nature of the show's finish. But Anno has long maintained that it was always the intended ending for Evangelion, without compromise. Dougurasufilm's breakdown of Ava's visual poetry, a short AMV that highlights Anno's love for recurring visuals, states simply that sometimes a repeated shot is a budget cut, and sometimes it's not. Throughout the series, it's quickly apparent that Anno's vision is a unique and calculated one. The finale is no different. Whilst those last two episodes garnered diehard defenders who speak to the personal way Ava's poetic, artistic and hopeful ending touched them, at the time it seemed that no one was happy, which, coincidentally, was kind of what Evangelion was saying all along, and a sentiment the franchise would double down on in the years to come. No one is ever happy. Still, despite the irony of it all, things took a more serious turn when death threats started arriving at the office. Such was the swell of rage at such an ambiguous close that Gainax and Anno actually succumbed and started work on an alternate ending, known, fittingly, as the end of Evangelion. This 80-minute feature acts as a more straightforward retelling of those final episodes, adapting their more ethereal storytelling to the physical plane fans were used to, and in doing so, close out the show with consequence, with weight and physicality, with despair. In a beautiful but heart-wrenching movie, full to bursting with unbelievable animation and revelations that gut the viewer's love for the show and its characters, Anno fought back. End of Evangelion is a thinly veiled assault, an attack on anyone entitled enough to demand an alternate ending, and it's a brutal and fitting riposte. It is the opposite of a love letter, a creator-led display of pained rebellion and disappointment that have not seen echoed since. There is a dichotomy at the heart of Ava's dual endings. The original represents hope, a promise for the future, whilst the other undeniably sings of despair, of a cycle doomed to repeat itself. At a glance, they are diametrically opposed, not unlike our heroines Rei and Asuka. Calm and reckless, calculating and reactionary, acceptance and rejection, love and hate. Much like these leads, the endings seem utterly unable to coexist, but upon closer inspection and a couple of rewatches, they reveal themselves to be two sides of the same coin. One will speak more to you as a viewer. Indeed, once Evangelion at large begins its descent into madness, it will become an incredibly personal one. But don't be misled. Much like how Ava juxtaposes its bloodiest moments with upbeat pop or classical triumphs, this hope and despair are meant to be consumed simultaneously. Taken together, their dissonance forms a much more coherent, cohesive and balanced close to Evangelion, and it's truly an outstanding one at that. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Gainax would go on to become one of the most consistently surprising studios in animation, creating wildly over-the-top and enjoyable shows that relished in subverting genre conventions. With generation-defining and wide-reaching hits such as Fooly Cooly, Gurren Lagann and Panty and Stocking, they quickly became a force to be reckoned with. But before long, they had found themselves doing so largely without the help of Anno. He formed Studio Okara in 2007, and there began adapting Evangelion once more. In Evangelion, the new theatrical edition, also known as the rebuild of Evangelion, Anno sought not to explore the cerebral core of Eva and the questions its characters left us with, but to focus almost entirely on the spectacle of the piece. Taken on their own, these movies can be found wanting, missing the meditative, introspective and altogether doomed soul of the series. Their myriad of punches lack weight, and they do a disservice to the depth and nuance that made the show such a hit. Their pacing is skewed, with incredible angel attacks being reduced to punctuation so as to break up a set of movies that threaten to buckle under their bloated scripts. It all sounds rather damning, but like End of Evangelion before it, I believe the rebuilds are to be taken as a companion piece rather than as a replacement, and it's with this approach that they truly shine. If you're fresh off an Eva binge, they complement that often heavy drama with some much-needed levity, and more than a few stunning set pieces. Their balletic fight scenes are unbelievably choreographed, with spectacular visuals that elevate the action to dizzying heights. Story elements in the original that felt rushed, or worse still, convenient, are introduced earlier to make them seem more intentional and less like Anno trying to tie up loose ends, or getting sidetracked with a stroke of genius too late in the game. As long as you're willing to piece them together yourself, the rebuilds are an excellent addition to an already stellar franchise. Until, that is, 3.0 changed the game. With the ironically titled You Cannot Redo, Anno began reworking Eva's ending once again. If you thought the pivot of the series' final moments was a lurching affair, I can safely say you haven't seen anything yet. 3.0 flips the script in such unbelievable fashion that I was left more than a little shaken by the time its credits began to crawl, and more convinced than ever that Anno was a madman we accidentally mistook for a genius. As we approach the final film in the Rebuild series, due out early next year, I anticipate with a mix of apprehension and excitement the third End of Evangelion, the impact of which will undoubtedly send shockwaves throughout the community once more. Whilst the conclusion will likely be a far less painful one than those we have currently, a sign, perhaps, of Anno's improving mental condition, it will certainly be just as controversial. Evangelion has been many things in the years since its debut. A strong start that descended fully into madness. A clear directorial vision muddied by his own cries for help. A genre-bending, convention-defying deconstruction of anime itself. But the most important thing Eva ever achieved was the personal hit it became with those who devoured it, who saw something of themselves in the broken kids and adults that peopled its varied cast, who found satisfaction, relief, comfort or even anger at its curtain call, because even hating it required you to care in the first place. Evangelion is one of those rare pieces of media that has a unique voice for whoever interacts with it. A YouTube video might be able to explain what Evangelion means, but it will never be able to tell you what Evangelion will mean to you. So close this one, and go find out for yourself. I promise it will be worth your time. As always, thanks for watching. As one of the most important, influential, and incredible series out there, the thought of tackling Evangelion always intimidated me. Luckily, in the 3 months since I've been working on this project, I've had the help and input of so many of my closest friends. This really became an ensemble piece, and I just want to thank every name you're seeing flash past who helped make this the best video it could be. I've also got to say a massive thank you to all the patrons who pledged to fund this video in its entirety. I really wouldn't have gotten around to this otherwise. If you want to help fund future projects, or just check out that incredible cover of Komm, süsser Todd without me talking all over it, head over to the Patreon and pledge a buck. Otherwise, you can always subscribe here on YouTube or follow me over at Twitter. If, instead, you just want me to get in the damn robot, hit the like button and I'll submerge myself in a bathtub full of Fanta.
If you thought Evangelion was filled with existential dread and metaphysical crises, just wait until the next episode. A woman haunted by the ghosts of her childhood toys, the lines of reality that blur and break. I think Joe's gonna need a little help with this one. Oh, and if you stick around, you might even get a little fan service.